Now, when you talk about accidents, what do you think is the number one cause of accidents from operating fork trucks?
Carelessness.
I'm sorry?
Carelessness.
Carelessness, which I would put that into not paying attention. Yeah, yeah, that's exactly what it is. Studies out there that they show. OSHA tells us that in any given year, of the 5,900 people who lose their lives, about 100 to 125 are associated with operating a fork truck. They're either because they were operators, something fell on them, something fell off on them, they fell off, they turned it over, or they ran over somebody. Okay, so it's an ongoing problem. And inattention, if you will, is the biggest problem. Why? Going back to what I just spoke about with the hazards. We just kind of get complacent. We get used to it and we just go cruising along. Number two is tip over. Tip overs come about because, again, of the suspension and the way they're designed. They're a tricycle. And again, going back to our childhood days when we rode tricycles, they were easy to tip over. Same thing here. You have unstable loads. In other words, we picked up something that's going to fall off. Okay? Operator struck by, and again, even though there's a guard up there, depending on what we're doing, it falls off and it strikes the operator. You have an elevated employee. Now, if we always follow the rules, they're not taxis, so you don't have employees there, and if you've got them in a cage, you're okay. But still, we have having some problems with elevating employees and accidents occurring. You have lack of training. Here is another issue. The only way you get better, as I said before, with a forklift is to drive it. But if we don't start and train in the beginning, then we don't have the opportunity to correct some of the deficiencies that we see. I learned to drive a fork truck about 50 years ago. Matter of fact, probably about 55 years ago. I was about 15 years old. Right? And in those days, there were no rules and regulations. They even were still like, they were driven like a car. They had a three-speed shift on them. Okay, you clutched and you shifted it and you went on down the road. Okay, not like you have today. Right? But they didn't train us. All they did was say, they would yell someplace, fork or lift or whatever, and whoever was fastest got to get on the forklift. Now, I'm just like you when I was 16. If it had four wheels, I wanted to drive it, right? I couldn't wait. So I was ready. And when they called, I was the fastest, and I would get my chance. But we had no formal training. How we got through it, I don't know, but we got through it. But now it's a problem, so we stop and we train, so we don't have those issues. Overload or improper use. Now again, we're using the fork for a reason that it was not intended, and that leads to accidents, so that can contribute. So these are the major causes of accidents, if you will, that we see out there operating fork trucks. Now to give you just some traveling tips, here's how you drive. Observe all the traffic regulations. Now, are there some regulations out there?
Yeah.
Right? There's some places you drive, some places you don't. It's marked on the floor. Okay? So, yeah, the places that you do. So you always want to observe the traffic regulations. You want to operate the unit at safe speeds. Now, a safe speed is basically described as a fast walking pace. Now, what is a fast walking pace? Give me a guess. A fast walking pace. Faster than normal, but it's about 4 miles an hour, okay? If I get out here and I just strike out down the road, in an hour, I will have covered about 4 miles, okay? So that's about 4 miles an hour. So it's not much faster than that, all right? So safe speed. Maintain safe following distances, which means that, okay, about 3 truck lengths between you and the guy in front of you. That's the same concept that we have out on the freeway. That you're going down the freeway, you want to leave enough distance between you and the guy in front of you that you can react. If you're out on the freeway and you leave 3 car lengths between you and the guy in front of you, what happens? 3 guys will get in there, right? Exactly right. That's the way it works. But the design is, the purpose is, that you're going to leave enough room that you can react to whatever the guy in front of you is reacting to. Yield right of way to pedestrians. And we talked about this before. But regardless of where the pedestrian is, they always have the right of way. Doing this training session a couple of months ago for a group, came to this point, and the guy said, if a pedestrian is in a restricted area and shouldn't be there, does he still have the right of way?
Yes.
Does he?
Yes.
Sure he does. Okay. You'd think it wouldn't be necessary to ask that question, but he did. He thought, okay, we'll find out. No, pedestrians always got the right of way, so you want to yield to it. Okay? You want to sound horn at cross aisles or when backing. Now, let me expand that out. Okay. Many times when I go out and work in facilities and go out and do safety audits, that's what we're doing. We're trying to see what's going on there that's safe or unsafe. And when you get out into the plant, wherever you are, the forklift horn starts sounding. And the people I'm with, I've had several people say this to me, they never sound the horn if I'm not out here. Okay, you sound the horn when you think that somebody needs to know that you're around. Now this says cross aisles, or when backing. That's appropriate, all right? But any other time that you think that, somebody needs to know you're around, then you need to sound your horn, and that's what you want to do. So they do know that you're around, and that's exactly what you're for. You want to maintain an unobstructed view. Now again, when you've got the mast in front of you, you may have a load, and so you may be having to move in reverse. And that's okay, that's appropriate, that's the easy way to do it. You can't rely on your mirrors. You have mirrors up here, like you can't back it like you're backing an 18-wheel trailer. You want to turn in the direction that you're traveling and look in the direction that you're going, but maintain an unobstructed view. Slow down on wet, slippery surfaces. You guys don't have this particular situation here, but at many facilities they do, depending on what they're doing. A lot of you have food processing plants, their floors are wet. You have some situation where they go in and out in the winter in the rain. Obviously, that dictates a little bit different condition, and so you always want to slow down on wet, slippery surfaces, if you will. Some other things, load should be lowered as far as possible and tilted backwards. Now, here's the thing. You want it about 4 to 6 inches off of the floor, right? And you want to tilt the back because you're going to let gravity keep your load there. But let me point out something else to you. When you're traveling with your forks, with an unloaded forks, you're empty. You also want to keep it up far enough, 4 to 6 inches, and tilted back. You don't want your forks tilted forward because if you don't have them high enough, you jab something in the floor and it's going to raise the rear end up. So always keep them up enough, tilted back a little bit, so that you can safely move the fork wherever you need to go. Should not be any stunt driving or horseplay. Now this is a given, but human nature being what it is, we get out there and my buddy's on one and I'm on the other. But that's really a no-no that we're not going to follow. Anytime you're going in and out of a trailer, now we'll talk about this in a few minutes, before you go in and out of a trailer, you want to make sure that it's safe for you to do so. One of the things is to make sure your dock plates are in a position and secure. Avoid running over objects. Now you run over objects, not only can you damage the tire, but then if that object shoots out and becomes a projectile, now you've injured somebody. So if there's something there in the aisle, stop, pick it up, don't run over it. Anytime you're turning, slow down and turn in a smooth, even manner. Okay? Just so that, again, depending on where your load is, okay, you're going to do it in a way that you're not going to swing your load off of there. Anytime you're going up a grade, you're going to go up, ascend or descend slowly. And then also, anytime you're going up or down, the load should be on the uphill side of the grade. So when you've got a load on, if you're going up, you're going up forward. When you're up there and you load up and you're coming down, you're going to back down so that the load is always on the uphill side of the grade. When you park the vehicle, several things that you want to be aware of. Number one, you park it outside of the flow of traffic, right? You park it and forks should be lowered to the floor. Controls in neutral position, power shut off, and the brakes set. And then wheels blocked if parked on an incline. You may or may not have that problem. But again, these are the things that you want to make sure of. And one of the things that we do when we certify you is we will tell you, do this particular little route, come back, park it, and dismount. And when you park it and dismount, this is how you should leave it, so that it is completely off and the forks are down. Also, it says if you are parking around a railroad track, park at least 8 feet from the center of any railroad track. And again, you don't have that particular situation here, but there are companies that do that load out rail cars, so they have that problem. Then let me point out one other thing to you, okay? Sometimes we get in discussions about when is a vehicle unattended? Can we leave it running? And here's what the regulation says. If the vehicle is unattended, if the driver is 25 feet or more away from a vehicle that remains in view. So if it's sitting over there, I'm 25 feet over here and I can see it, okay? It can still be running, if you will, or operating the way that it is. However, if the operator leaves a vehicle and it is not in view, so now if it's sitting right here, my vehicle, and I walk around over here and I can't see it, now I got to shut that down and set it just as we've described here. So it does go out of service depending upon how you are leaving it and where you are leaving it. When you're lifting, lift only stable, well-arranged loads, meaning that you've looked at what you're lifting, you've identified that it is sitting on the pallet in a way that it's safe to lift, and then you can lift. Lift only loads within the truck's capacity. You're not ever going to overlift. And again, that's what the little card is for, the little placard's there for to tell you what it is. Fully engage the forks, keeping load close to the lift. Again, put them all the way in. And again, one of the things I look for when I certify is to make sure that the forks are all the way underneath the load. Now, sometimes you may be going up and there's a load up here and I can't get all the way up and underneath it. Lift it up safely, back out, set it down, and then fully engage your forks. That may be necessary. Never add additional counterweights. Now, let me qualify this, and I will tell you this. On the little quiz here, there apparently is a question. Is that somebody said, that's a trick question. I didn't intend it for a trick question, okay? But it may well be. Never add additional counterweights. Now, here's the issue. You can add additional counterweights approved by the manufacturer, okay? What this was intended to say, if I'm out there, I'm, you know, it's just a Wednesday afternoon, and I want to lift this load, and it's greater than the capacity of my truck, and I'm going to go over, and I'm going to get 500 pounds and set it on the back. That's the counterweight we're talking about. Can't do that. You got to get it approved by the manufacturer. Okay. So, never add additional counterweights. Carefully place and release loads. Don't drop it. Okay. Get it set squarely where you're going to put it, and then put it down. And then remember, the higher the lift, the higher the center of gravity, and the more unstable. Now let's look at that from one different direction. We look at the stability triangle of a forklift, and that's what it looks like here. If we're looking down on a lift, here's the forks. Here's what we call the stability triangle, ABC, right? When you look at the center of gravity, it's approximately where you would sit in the seat. As you add weight to it, okay, as weight is added, center of gravity moves forward because we're adding it out here, right? When you are at the maximum capacity of the truck, the center of gravity is approximately between B and C here, right? Or at the front axle. Now, what happens if you add additional weight? Additional load. What happens if I add additional load out here? I'm going to tip it forward, right? If I want to put on a counterweight, I'm going to put it back here, right? That's what we're talking about. You can't do that. Now, it changes. Remember this. It changes every time you lift in a load. Look at this one. All right. Here you have your truck, right here. Here's the truck center of gravity. Here you have your load. You got it up here. Here's your load center of gravity. There is then between them a combined center of gravity. And if you notice the dotted line here, as long as that dotted line stays between the foundation of the wheels, between the wheels, you have a fairly stable load. But now let's go up a little higher, a little farther out. Here's your load center of gravity. Here's your truck center of gravity. Here's your combined. And now you notice where the combined center of gravity is falling, outside the base of your wheels. Now you have an unstable load. So again, remember this. Every time you lift, move around, that is changing. One of the things I often see when I'm in plants where guys are good driving forklifts, all right? They go whipping down through there, they're going to put their load up there, and they will start raising their load well before they get there. And as they get there, then they swing in like this, okay? Now, what problem has that created? This one right here. The higher that load, the more you have it out there, the greater the tendency is to swing. So if you're swinging too quickly, okay, you've increased the possibility, excuse me, of tipping it over. So be aware of that. Same thing happens when you come out. They'll often come out like this and start it down as they're already leaving. So make sure you come out, you set it down, and then you turn and go where you need to go.